request Pastor Gina Acharya to come on to the dais. And Prakash Ambedkar. And I also request Prakash Ambedkar to come on to the dais.
Which is life of a nation. and where everybody should have control over it. He said that should be in the hands of the government, and therefore he divides his own economy when it comes to states and minority into essential industry, necessary industry, and then into the auxiliary sector. And therefore he said, what is essential is the lifeline of the nation. And in any country, you have certain sectors, economic sectors, which become the lifeline of the country, and said this lifeline of the country should be open to all rather than a monopoly of the few. And therefore he suggested that the economic policy, if they become a part of the constitution, then this, which is the lifeline of the country, should be public control. And to make it a public control, it has to be a government control. And then it becomes that the government becomes the empire again, when the people start demanding that this is what I want, this is what I want, and therefore the government can play a role of an empire. Today what is happening is we are fighting against each other. And to explain it more better, I will say so that during the 50s to 1980, in the 1990s, we have the government sector expanding. We have the private sector expanding. We have the bank maximization. And the employment was also expanding. With the expansion of the government sector and the banking sector, there was one way of empowerment of the society, financial empowerment or economic empowerment of the society, in the sense that the salarized class got the benefit of the treasury, government treasury. But during those period, if you see the education level between the SC, ST and the OBCs and the economically backward classes, we find that they have not even come up to 50%. In the 90s, there was again a new trend, as I may say so, that from the shoe caste, people had diversified into educational field, into different field, and they began the competitive. As a student, I would like to invite your attention that we say that we took the new economic policy because there was a balance of payment crisis. I dispute that. And therefore, I'm saying as a student, you should also dispute it. For a simple reason, there were two crises that took place. In India, we had a balance of payment crisis, that is true. But at the same time, internationally, there was also a crisis in the sense that Kuwait was annexed by Iraq. And if you look at the Indian balance of payment, a large amount of money would come from the Middle East rather than from the European continent or from the American continent. If I may say so, 5% would only come from Europe and the American continent, 95% would come as a remittance from the Gulf countries. Due to the annexation of Kuwait, government of India stopped accepting the remittance from Kuwait, and therefore we didn't have any payment left. We were bankrupt on the balance of payment, and therefore what was told to us that we were forced by the World Bank to change this situation. In fact, this was a man-made situation, as we call it, because as far as I know, Madam Indira Gandhi followed what was known as Marwadi economy. That's a better term to use for her economy. But she always knew that she was in loggerhead with the Americans. It may be Nixon, it may be the early presidents also. And therefore, not to falter on balance of payment, she would always keep what the Marwadis would do, a certain portion aside. And that would not be touched. It was a like of security, you can see. She used it as a security. That look, this is what I have, I can meet you at any time. And therefore, she avoided being declared default on balance of payment many a times during her period. And therefore, I would like the students over here to make a very concrete effort that what was the amount of default during the balance sheet crisis in the 1989-1991? And suppose what was the remittance from the Kuwait? Only Kuwait, I'm not asking of the whole of Middle East. Because government of India at that time made a statement that we will not accept the Kuwait currency because it was under the siege of Iraq. And that, I think so, accelerated the whole situation and what we have a new economic policy. I'll come to that later on. But as I was saying, with the expansion of the administrative unit, both of the banking and the government sector, who benefited? The beneficiaries were the upper class. Economically, they became stronger. And later on, when it came to the terms of SC, ST and OBC to get into the government and the banking sector, we all of a sudden have, in 1990, the privatization coming into place. And the government sector shrinking in all fields. So I may say so that the OBC, ST and the tribals were deprived of the benefits when they started learning and getting educated themselves. When you speak of public finances, I think so we have to look at what kind of resources the government usually transfers. But this is a society where even today if you see, even in today's context, if you see the person below poverty line is something like 26%. Just above poverty line is 50%. And we have a GDP growth which is around about 8%. Therefore, the growth even today is cornered just by 24%. And therefore, I'm saying as a student, you should be able to quantify who are these 22% and what is the growth every year. In monetary terms, that is being transferred to these 22-24%. I think so. There we will be able to lay down the parameters as to the rich and the poor and the gap at what rate it is increasing. This is one issue, I think so, which is there. The next is what will happen after the GATT agreement on education has taken place, comes into place. I'm told there's 1 year monitor which has been given. Officially, I can't say that. This is what is unofficially I've been told, that 1 year monitor is there. And once if that comes into the play, then all kinds of educational subsidies that we are enjoying today will have to be sacrificed. It is not yet sure whether the reservation policy will also come within that sphere of GATT agreement. Some are saying yes, some are saying no. But leaving apart whether reservation comes into that policy or no, there was a fundamental change, a fundamental responsibility that was brought in by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, was that he made education the responsibility of the government. 1991 policy changed that fundamental change and made the education the responsibility of the family. And this is where I think so the public opinion is most important. What system do you want? And this is where the common man has to decide in a democracy. If he doesn't decide, then it is the political bosses who decide as to how this country should run. If we are going to say that the education has to be within our limits, then we have to see that the education remains into the hands of the government and not into the private sector. The common man today is a dichotomy. And the dichotomy is that one hand he wants to become rich at the same time and at the same time he wants the government control also. And therefore, you see, today there are parent teachers association coming up in various parts of the country and demanding that the fees structure should be restricted. This is a contradiction by itself, that you want the government to play a role of a regulator, and at the same time you don't want to give the instrument of regularities with the government. And this again I will relate, that this is related to the caste thinking of our process, that we are not ready to decide what is my individual freedom and what is my community freedom. Because individual freedom and community freedom are two different things. Individual freedom is I express myself, and the community feeling, which is also expressed, might not be the same. They might differ. And once they differ, the question comes along, then which is to be accepted or which is to be followed. And that's what we see today happening, that the individual freedom is sought to be subjugated to the community freedom, and therefore you find some of them expressing that I will not accept them. And therefore there are certain issues which I may say, so if you are going to follow a democratic pattern of system in this country, the people have to decide whether they want education to be a family affair, or whether they want education to be in the hands of the government. Because it's only when the education in the hands of the government that I can demand or you can demand that you must spend 7% of the public finances on the education. If you are going to say that no, there has to be a private education system, then we can't demand that the public exchanges funds should be expanded or should be spent on the education system. Thirdly, then we can't even agitate that the education fees has to be controlled. Whoever is parting the education in an open market, then he has a right as to what cost he is going to part that education with. The concept of freedom, as far as individuality is concerned, it is unfettered. But when it comes to the question of welfare, we have to start making a distinction. And that distinction, I think so, is very well articulated in the Constitution. Where individual rights are concerned, they come under the fundamental rights. And when the welfare of the nation or welfare of the society is concerned, they come under the direct principles. So any issue coming under the direct principle, I'm just laying down a small guideline for anybody who wants to distinguish between these two. Anything coming under the direct principles is a community issue. And we should say that this issue should be in the hands of the government. And therefore, when Dr. Ambedkar, as I said, spoke of certain issues, a certain economic sector should be a national property, and certain sectors should be in the hands of the state, he had the directive principles in his mind, which were being framed simultaneously during those period, that if you want to have a welfare in a country where there was no welfare, if you want to make a society a part of a ruling class which was not there earlier, he has to be trained. That has to be imbibed in him. And once that imbibes in him, then he will start taking a decision. And that decision process starts when he starts agitating and when he starts demanding. Today, both the process in this country has stopped. And therefore, we find that people basically are grouping in the dark in which manner to go and which direction. Before closing down, I'll come to one of the issues where you come to public finances and say, there are two issues which I have said. Had Dr. Ambedkar's concept, economy of a nation life, should be a part of the constitution, that itself would have been a worldwide phenomenon. what we see today happening in the Middle East is the control of oil. If anybody wants to go great detail into it, there is a book published, I think, in 1994 by the name of Great Oil Game by Ahmad Rashid, who is a Pakistani, who is a Pakistani citizen. And he has given a wonderful picture starting at the beginning of the oil game, whose interest is what, and how countries are going to react later on. If you read that book with Samuel Hamilton's Clash of Civilization, both together, the situation that is developing today, I think so, none of us would be surprised. But that is what was basically planned out. And what was being planned out is today is being executed, as I may say so. So therefore, one of the issues which, as a student of economics, we should focus on in the today's world is that there is a demographic changes that are taking place in the Europe. We have an explosion of population in the Asian countries. This is on one hand. Secondly, you find again what happens in the gap. It's now been discussed at international level that it should be rediscussed again. Thirdly, if you see what has happened in Europe, what has happened in Britain, you find a clear-cut divide between the capitalists and the socialists. And socialism is again reviving in Great Britain. That they say, no, we don't want to do anything, we want to take care of our own economy rather than integrate into other economy and buy their headache into our economy. I'm not going to deal in it. So these are changes which are taking place. I think so these are changes taking place because each, no doubt we say each economy is depending upon the other. And in this fast moving world, each country is going to be dependent on the other. But that dependency should not lead to creating of a banana republic. Because once it leads into a creating of a banana republic, then you have revolts. And then you have a kind of war where you are superior in weapons, then the human body becomes the bombs. So that is what is happening today. And therefore I said that this issue of Dr. Ambedkar as far as finances are concerned needs to be relooked again in the present context. The other two, I think so, are more controversial, if I may say so. When we began as a nation, we had two crises in our hands. One was Tibet crisis, and the other was Pak occupied India. Dr. Ambedkar was the view that we should recognize Tibet as an independent country. Once we do that, the rest of the world will start. And between India and China, there will be a buffer. But he wanted that buffer. If you read his later part of his speech, somewhere in 53, if I am not wrong, in the Rasa Sabha, which he made, he predicted 1962. And he said, had my advice been accepted during those periods, we would not have this situation. By not accepting his suggestion as far as Tibet is concerned, as a student of economics, I think so, you should now look into the drain that is taken on the public exchange. As he lamented in his own book, during the British period, in the East India companies, that 60% of the budget was spent on milk. Are not the same thing happening today? One political mistake. And one political mistake is now costing the exchange. The same he said about Papa. Okay. Take a decision. He said, if you don't take a decision, you will bleed rest of the life. And today, the scarce resources of the nation, finances, are bleeding only because to save part of the money. It's an emotional issue as far as I can see, but after all, rationality has to prevail upon. And this rationality will prevail upon only when some of you start codifying what is the cost of not taking a decision in the last 70 years. And do we want that same thing to continue for another 70 years? When I was in college, I had read a book, Thousands of Years of War by Kennedy. And he said that no war in the world was without economy. Every war before it was fought, it was analyzed that if we win, what will be the gain? And if we lose, what will be the losses? So any decision, taken or not taken, I think so, it has to be quantified in terms of finances. And they, I think so, are more important. But had these resources not been spent on defense, what we see today in the public policy, to build roads, we have rules. Because there is no exchange, there is no fund in the exchange to build the roads. What we see today, that the health should have been in the government sector, but is again cropped up into the private sector. Education, I've already mentioned. Every aspect of welfare state is slowly by slowly being brought into the domain of private arena. And one of the reasons which I can see is that the exchanger is getting shrunk day by day, or whatever is being collected in the exchanger is spent on maintaining the unity and the whole administrative structure of the country. This brings me to the last point, that the states have been saddled with the responsibility of looking after the nation and the people. In 2003, when I was working on some issues, I came across what is the debt, actual debt of the states. It was something like 7 lakhs crores. It might have jumped to 9 lakhs crores to be. Which is actual debt. I'm not saying of the true debt system that you have, the government write-off system and the actual physical borrowing in the bank. Physical borrowing from the banks and the other financial institutions that the state takes place, is something around like 9 lakhs crores. If you study and look at the Soviet Russia, it collapsed under the weight of financial crisis. Are we heading in that direction? This is a major subject for the student of public finance. I know this has not been spoken of. There is very little write-up on this. If there is, I am not able to. I can say I am illiterate as far as anybody who has written and analyzed on that. But I am not able to lay my hands on it. As a student, instead of looking into abstract subjects, we should look into the present and we should look into the past. We should look into the present and we should look what will be the future. But these are issues which manifest suddenly. And once they manifest, it becomes very difficult to be brought under control. At least I can say today we are safe from a price rise only because the oil prices have gone up. Or to be thankful that 26/11 has happened. But there are games within games that are being played. Economy, as somebody in the morning said, that what is taught in the school and what is taught outside the school is different. And I learned it very fast that what is studied in books has no relevance in public life. To make it more relevant, I think so, we should be related to the present issues, then it will become more relevant. Before closing, I will just say a last thing, that there are certain areas where the public financial should make an assertion in itself. And that is control over the labor, land, capital, service good and production thereof. That's one. Then there is a social resource sector, and this is basically related to social status. But you get social status only when you have some kind of resources with you. And this is political resources, as I may say so, is one of the most important weapons. And if political resource is to be exercised, there has to be a political morality. And that political morality means that I am going to exercise my vote without any fear and without any expectations. If it is exercised in that manner, then what we are seeing in the system today, it might change. Otherwise, not only the capitalist, but capitalist and casteist will also join hands to not only have control over the system, but also to build up a system through which you can loot the common man. And as I would say, the price rise that takes place always is looting of a common man rather than taxing him. Then you have the physical resources, and this is where I think so the government started the plan, the component plan comes into play. Recently we have the government of India starting a program where industrialization within the scheduled class and scheduled tribe starts, but they have been a non-starter, so they put across. There is ample fund, so I don't blame the government that there is no fund at all. There is some inherent defects in that whole scheme. As it was pointed out in the earlier session, that intention of the person sitting is most important. As Dr. Ambedkar said, that any constitution, if it is bad, the intention is good, it won't work. But however good a constitution may be, the intention bad is going to bring. So the intention is most important. And here I think so, sensitization of the implementers is absolutely necessary in one aspect. Second aspect is what needs to be examined. In this bureaucratic system, can a banking angle be introduced in it? One. The third, which is necessary, if I may say so, is we are helping a person who doesn't have resources at all. If that is the case, then whether his contribution is going to be made by him or by somebody else, I think that's one issue. Second is, if he has the ability, should we or should we not move on and saying that since he has the ability, these schemes should finance him 100% and let him work out the whole school. These are some of the inherent defects, and I think so somebody should take up the job of codifying those inherent defects in the first place. Second place, quantifying as to what changes are necessary in these schemes to become more popular in one sense and also implementable in the other sense. The last one which I come to is the cultural resources. I have my own theory on culture, which many do not believe. Culture is related to weapons. I don't mean those arms weapons. I mean to a production of a weapon, a stick, you can see, or a drumstick, or something of a thing which has to do with metals. You have a caste in this country for whom metal was worth. That means he was not allowed to touch the metal. The metal was basically the instrument of the backward classes and the shudras and the anti-shudras, to put it in those sense. So we had culture developed from them, and they developed a wonderful culture. Today what's happening is that that culture is being looked upon as a Dalit culture. And what was supposed to be a Dalit culture, which was a temple culture, Odisha dance, if you say, it's a temple culture. The Karnataki dance, if you say, it's a temple culture. It's a dance of the rulers, which had the angle of exploitation of a woman's body. And this culture of the Dalits, which had not only the angle of enjoyment, but also participation of the community as a such into his own system, that was looked down upon as a culture. It doesn't have a face, it doesn't have a backing, or you may say so, and not a good culture. So this is one, I think so, where the Dalit themselves should appreciate their own culture, should propagate their own culture, should use their own weapons, the instruments which they use. These are instruments, and these are musical instruments, these are folklores, which has been developed by them, and it is their own culture. And the moment this culture is ascertained that this is our culture, then what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar said, that the Indian society suffers from two slaveries. One is the physical slavery and the other is the mental slavery. Addressing mental slavery now is the first concern, as I may see so. And this mental slavery can be overcome, as I said, from this cultural program. Lastly, before concluding, I will just put across a last point, and that is question of preservation. It has to do with public finances. Do we look reservation as a development? Or do we reservation as an assurance that the percentage will not be less than this? How we look at it? Today, everybody, when he speaks of reservation as a method of development. I don't see reservation as a method of development. I see it as an assurance to those classes of people who were never a part of a government, that look here, we are forming into a new nation. And by forming a new nation, we assure you that your percentage will not be less than this. Having accepted this, then the next question comes, is what should be our development for the society as a whole? There again I will come to an issue where the common man has to decide. It is not the policy makers who has to decide. It is not the intellectual who has to decide. It is not the analytical who has to decide. It's a common man who has to decide what kind of development model he wants. Like Sikh, to put it in words, we had two kinds of development model. One was a labor intensive model and one was a capitalist intensive model. The capitalists didn't want the labor problem with him, therefore he went for capital intensive. And when he went for capital intensive, there was labor dispersal. Today when we look at the whole system, do we want to look at a development policy which includes this 15% and speaks of 100%? Or do we speak of 100% and then speak of 15%? That is the issue. I would say a time has come for us to change. That we speak of 100% and then see whether the 15% is there or not. Not a question that we look into whether the 100%, whether the 15% is there or not. This is a fundamental change, and this fundamental change is going to cost the public exchange the most. Because then, once you accept this, then your parameters for other things also changes, and to change those parameters, then the public exchange is going to be put as a severe stress, because then you will have to build in all those new infrastructures so that you adjust according to the new policy. And therefore, I may say so that this generation is at a crossroad. At a crossroad, on one hand, he wants everything open for himself with no restrictions. And on the other hand, he has an expectations from the government. He will have to decide whether his freedom is limited to himself, only to himself, or he would like this freedom to be extended into other spheres. If he wants it to be extended into other spheres, he should not speak of a welfare state. He should not accept anything, he should not expect anything from the government. But if you are expecting from the government, then what needs to be done is, my individual liberty is only individual liberty. That has 100% freedom. But when it comes to the community life, or when it comes to the nation, or when it comes to the person living within the nation, his welfare has to be done. And there, we'll have to place all things into the hands of the government. This is an issue which present generation will have to decide. The changes I have said within the capitalist world has begun. The changes within the capitalist world has begun, and it's very amply demonstrated. If anybody looks at the situation in which Great Britain voted whether to be in the European Union or whether not to be in the European Union, the cut-off line, as I have said, the rich said that we should be with the European Union. The poverty line, using in the Indian context, or the labor class you can say, within the labor, said no, we are not going to vote for the union, but we would like to have an independence. That issue has again cropped up, and this issue is going to again crop up before the Indian society. I think so, you will have to decide, because your decision is going to state, as I have said, whether we become a banana republic, whether we become a separate state, whether we remain an independent, that decision is in your hand. Thank you. Every aspect of welfare state is slowly by slowly being brought into the domain of private arena. And one of the reasons which I can see is that the exchanger is getting shrunk day by day, or whatever is being collected in the exchanger is spent on maintaining the unity and the whole administrative structure of the country. This brings me to the last point. That the states have been saddled with the responsibility of looking after the nation and the people. In 2003, when I was working on some issues, I came across what is the death, actual death of the states. It was something like 7 lakhs crores. It might have jumped from 9 lakhs crores to be. Which is actual death. I'm not saying of the true death system that you have, the government write-off system and the actual physical borrowing in the bank. Physical borrowing from the banks and the other financial institutions that the state takes place, is something around like 9 lakhs crores. If you study and look at the Soviet Russia, it collapsed under the weight of financial crisis. Are we heading in that direction? This is a major subject for the student of public finance. I know this has not been spoken of. There is very little write-up on this. If there is, I am not able to. I can say I am illiterate as far as anybody who has written and analyzed on that. But I am not able to lay my hands on that. As a student, instead of looking into abstract subjects, we should look into the present and we should look into the past. We should look into the present and we should look what will be the future. But these are issues which manifest suddenly. And once they manifest, it becomes very difficult to be brought under control. At least I can say today we are safe from a price rise only because the oil prices have gone up. Or to be thankful that 26/11 has happened again. But there are games within games that are being played. Economy, as somebody in the morning said, that what is taught in the school and what is taught outside the school is different. And I learned it very fast that what is studied in books has no relevance in public life. To make it more relevant, I think so we should be related to the present issues, then it will become more relevant. Before closing, I will just say the last thing, that there are certain areas where the public financial should make an assertion in itself, and that is control over the labor, land, capital, service good and production thereof. That's one. Then there is a social resource sector, and this is basically related to social status. But you get social status only when you have some kind of resources with you. And this is political resources, as I will say so, is one of the most important weapons. And if political resource is to be exercised, there has to be a political morality. And that political morality means that I am going to exercise my vote without any fear and without any expectations. If it is excised in that manner, then what we are seeing the system today, it might change. Otherwise, not only the capitalist, but capitalist and casteist will also join hands to not only have control over the system, but also to build up a system through which you can loop the government. And as I would say, the price rise that takes place always is looting of a common man rather than taxing. Then you have the physical resources. And this is where I think so the government started the plan, the component plan comes into play. Recently we have the government of India starting a program where industrialization within the scheduled class and scheduled tribe starts. But they have been a non-starter, so let me put it across. There's ample fund, so I don't blame the government that there's no fund at all. There is some inherent defects in that whole scheme. As it was pointed out in the earlier session, that intention of the person sitting is most important. As Dr. Ambedkar said, that any constitution, if it is bad, the intention is good, it won't work. But however good a constitution may be, the intention bad is going to bring. So the intention is most important. And here I think so, sensitization of the implementers is absolutely necessary in one aspect. Second aspect is what needs to be examined. In this bureaucratic system, can a banking angle be introduced in it? One. The third, which is necessary, if I may say so, is we are helping a person who doesn't have resources at all. If that is the case, then whether his contribution is going to be made by him or by somebody else, I think that's one issue. Second is, if he has the ability, should we or should we not move on and saying that since he has the ability, these schemes should finance him 100% and let him work out the whole scheme. These are some of the inherent defects, and I think so somebody should take up the job of codifying those inherent defects in the first place. Second place, quantify as to what changes are necessary in these schemes to be become more popular in one sense and also implementable in the other sense. The last one which I come to is the cultural resources. I have my own theory on culture, which many do not believe. Culture is related to weapons. I don't mean those arms weapons. I mean to a production of a weapon, a stick, you can see, or a drumstick, or something of a thing which has to do with metals. You have a class in this, you have a caste in this country for whom metal was worshipped. That means he was not allowed to touch the metal. The metal was basically the instrument of the backward classes and the shudras and the anti-shudras to put it in those sense. So we had culture developed from them and they developed a wonderful culture. Today what's happening is that that culture is being looked upon as a Dalit culture. And what was supposed to be a Dalit culture, which was a temple culture, Odisha dance, if you say, it's a temple culture. The Karnataki dance, if you say, it's a temple culture, it's a dance of the rulers, which had the angle of exploitation of a woman's body. And this culture of the Dalits, which had not only the angle of enjoyment, but also participation of the community as a such into his own system, that was looked down upon as a culture. It doesn't have a face, it doesn't have a backing, or you may say so, and not a good culture. So this is one, I think so, where the Dalit themselves should appreciate their own culture, should propagate their own culture, should use their own weapons. Not the weapons, but the instruments which they use, These are instruments, and these are musical instruments. These are folklores, which has been developed by them, and it is their own culture. And the moment this culture is ascertained that this is our culture, then what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar said, that the Indian society suffers from two slaveries. One is the physical slavery and the other is the mental slavery. Addressing mental slavery now is the first concern, as I may say so. And this mental slavery can be overcome, as I said, from this cultural program. Lastly, before concluding, I will just put across a last point, and that is question of preservation. It has to do with public finances. Do we look reservation as a development? Or do we look reservation as an assurance that the percentage will not be less than this? How we look at it? Today, everybody, when he speaks of reservation as a method of development. I don't see reservation as a method of development. I see it as an assurance to those classes of people who were never a part of a government, that look here, we are forming into a new nation. And by forming a new nation, we assure you that your percentage will not be less than this. Having accepted this, then the next question comes, is what should be our development for the society as a whole? There again I will come to an issue where the common man has to decide. It is not the policy makers who has to decide. It is not the intellectual who has to decide. It is not the analytical who has to decide. It's a common man who has to decide what kind of development model he wants. Like, see, to put it in words, we have two kinds of development model. One was a labor intensive model and one was a capitalist intensive model. The capitalists didn't want the labor problem with him, therefore he went for capital intensive. And when he went for capital intensive, there was labor dispersion. Today when we look at the whole system, do we want to look at a development policy which includes this 15% and speaks of 100%? Or do we speak of 100% and then speak of 15%? That is the issue. I would say a time has come for us to change. That we speak of 100% and then see whether the 15% is there or not. Not a question that we look into whether the 100%, whether the 15% is there or not. This is a fundamental change, and this fundamental change is going to cost the public exchange the most. But then, once you accept this, then your parameters for other things also changes, and to change those parameters, then the public exchange is going to be put as a severe stress, because then you will have to build in all those new infrastructures so that you adjust according to the new policy. And therefore, I may say so, that this generation is at a crossroad. At a crossroad, on one hand, he wants everything open for himself with no restrictions. And on the other hand, he has an expectations from the government. He will have to decide whether his freedom is limited to himself, only to himself, or he would like this freedom to be extended into other spheres, if he wants it to be extended into other spheres, he should not speak of a welfare state. He should not accept anything, he should not expect anything from the government. But if you are expecting from the government, then what needs to be done is, my individual liberty is only individual liberty. That has 100% freedom. But when it comes to the community life, or when it comes to the nation, or when it comes to the person living within the nation, his welfare has to be done. And there, we'll have to place all things into the hands of the government. This is an issue which the present generation will have to decide. The changes I have said within the capitalist world has begun. The changes within the capitalist world has begun, and it's very amply demonstrated. If anybody looks at the situation in which Great Britain voted whether to be in the European Union or whether not to be in the European Union, the cut-off line, as I've said, the rich said that we should be with the European Union. The poverty line, using the Indian in the Indian context, or the labor class, you can say, within the labor, said no, we are not going to vote for the union, but we would like to have an independence. That issue has again cropped up, and this issue is going to again crop up before the Indian society. I think so. You will have to decide, because your decision is going to state, as I've said, whether we become a banana republic, whether we become a separate state, whether we remain an independent. That decision is in your hand. Thank you.
Economic gathering. Thank you, sir. Now,